Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Fringe Dwellers, written by Nene Gare and read by Shareena Clanton. I wanted to start this book by saying I have a personal connection to this story. The story, in essence, is about Mary Malcolm Forrest and the children she was raising in the Geraldton sandhills, you know, at a time when blacks were relegated to the reserves and were disallowed entry into the main town centres. My great-grandmother, Mary Malcolm Forrest, was a proud woman who was articulate, wily, elegant, and she knew how to survive. My grandmother, Anne Trilby Forrest, was a younger daughter of the family. My grandmother's oldest sister, Tamisha, would often accompany her mother on visits and talks with Nene Gare. Mary Malcolm Forrest and her daughters were the chief inspiration behind the central characters of The Fringe Dwellers, Molly, Trilby and Noonah. And whilst The Fringe Dwellers is not totally factual, its story strongly mirrors the lives of my great-grandmother and her family. Both my grandmother and her sister went on to complete nursing, as it was one of the few professions that women were allowed entry into during that time that the book was written. My strength and wisdom as a black woman stems from these great role models, going from my great-grandmother down through to my grandmother and eventually to my mother. They are all women who have survived the ongoing struggles that Aboriginal people have had to endure over the generations. I hope you enjoy. To my friends with love. Chapter 1. Trilby paused to look back at the mission. The box-like buildings straggling either side of the wide roadway were ugly, utilitarian, and the only graceful note was lent by the tall, wide-reaching guns which shaded them. At this distance, the children's voices sounded like the carolling of birds, echoing and re-echoing as they laughed and called to each other. Trilby stuck a long leg over the boundary fence, lifting her skirt high above the line of barbed wire at the top. Safely over, she bent her head against the wind and continued her walk. Outside the fence, the slender-leaved wattles spread circular skirts to break the force of the southerly. In this dry, red land of northwestern Australia, the southerly blew all summer long, strong and straight. It blew Trilby's hair back from her face and drew her faded cotton skirt between her legs. It inclined her figure at an angle, and only her downbent gaze shielded her eyes from the flying red dust. Soon the mission was just a block of indistinct outlines, and the bell-like voices were truly those of the birds. A line of river guns appeared, and as they grew more distinct, Trilby speeded her steps. Under the trees was the riverbed, dry and sandy now, but still cool beneath the low trailing branches of the ghost gums. Trilby stopped to look wistfully at a mud-bottomed hollow that sometimes, when there had been good rains farther north, held water all through the long dry summer. But the rains had been sparse this year and the pool was dry. She stooped to brush a scurrying line of big black ants from a sandy spot beneath one of the trees. Then she settled herself down, her back against its trunk. Here, where the force of the wind was broken, there were small bushflies by the hundred. They settled on the girl's face and arms and legs and lost themselves in her hair. She leaned over to pick a frond of leaves to use as a fly switch. Trilby was classified as a half-caste. For years now she had lived at the mission. There were four of the Comeaways there, Trilby's older sister Noonah, and the young ones, 10-year-old Barty and the baby Stella, who was 6. Trilby had always hated the life, though the act of rebellion of her first year or so had dwindled to a dreary acceptance. Lighted only by the wild plans for the life she would lead when she was free, she dreamed of excitement and gaiety and laughter and joyous adventure. But these things did not belong to mission life. And until now, there had always been the cold awakening to this fact. Not today, though. Today, she would dream as much as she liked. One more night at the mission for herself and Noonah. one more night between herself and the wonder of pleasing herself what she did. Her mouth curled upward in ecstasy. With her face turned to the clear, strong light, it seemed that most of the dark blood in this girl had drained into hands and feet, leaving the skin of her face a glowing amber, highlighted with gold. There were stripes of gold in her hair too, over dark honey, but her eyes were her most outstanding feature. Between curving black lashes, they glinted like silver. Trilby's grandfathers, both of them, had been white. The cold arrogance of one had been scented in the narrow grey eyes that Trilby had inherited. From him, too, she had a slim height and a high-held head, and perhaps her stubborn, rebellious spirit. Back at the mission, she was considered a spitfire, cheeky and almost unmanageable. The other kids teased her about her strange light eyes, but Trilby was only acting when she bit back at them. At 15, she was not yet brave enough to tell them she liked to be different, and that she liked most to be different from coloured people. The lovely velvet brown eyes of most of the other children went unadmired. She preferred her own long, secretive eyes. She flung her careless arm across the tree and leant her soft cheek against its hard satin trunk. The sprays of delicate pointed leaves dipped and danced about her face. Across from her, in the very centre of the dry riverbed, a tortured gum grew almost parallel with the earth, but its foliage strained towards the sky, lifting and rippling as the wind drove it ever downward. The coarse white sand rose in clouds. The wind went flying through the leaves, and presently Trilby, in tune with her surroundings, flung straining arms tightly around her tree. Happiness leapt in her heart like a living thing, so that laughter was caught in her throat and strangled there. The hardness of the wood crushed her chest, but she only pressed closer to it, as if this was life itself she held in her arms. But at last there were tears as well as laughter, and the tears slipped down her cheeks and were bitter and salt on her tongue. There were two who sat on the steps of the schoolhouse in the late afternoon, and the faces of both were bleak and still. All the comfort Noonah had to give had been given, and the boy Barty was not comforted. Sitting on the step below her, he pressed himself against her legs, empty eyes watching the antics of a group of small boys rolling over and over in the red-dusted sand. Tomorrow Noonah would be gone. There was no thought more important than that, and so it was for Noonah. Tomorrow she must leave Barty and Stella behind to get on as well as they could without her. And the more she thought of the little things she had done for them, which nobody but an older sister turned mother would ever think of doing, much less have time to do in this crowded and busy mission, the more desolate grew her thoughts. They would miss her so. And how cruel that she, who loved them, should be forced to withdraw herself from them and leave them alone. She slipped an arm over Barty's shoulders, and when the boy looked up at her, inquiringly, she smiled at him. The unutterably tender and reassuring smile of a mother for her child. Barty questioned her with his eyes, and the girl searched swiftly for words that had not been said before.
What you have to remember is that it's not going to be for long, see? I'll ask them as soon as I get down there and tell them that you and Stella have to come down too. And if there isn't any room where they are, I'll make them shift somewhere or build another little place just for you and Stella. See?
But 10 is not a looking forward age. Nothing the future held had power enough to drag Barty's mind off the present. Morning, Noonah watched his dark eyes fill and brim until the boy dropped his head in shame, and she could see only the curling black hair. Unable to bear his misery, she scrambled to her feet.
Barty, I have to say goodnight to Stella again. I want to see her just once more before.
She stopped.
Come with me, she begged, before the bell goes for you too.
Barty nodded, blinking his eyes. The two walked off, and as they walked their hands brushed and would have clung. But not here. Not until they had left the others behind them.
Mrs. Gordon cut our hair, mine and Trilby's, and she let us use some of her shampoo, Noonah said cheerfully. It smelt nice too.
Barty cast a brief look at Noonah's hair, swinging like a bell over thin shoulders and cut in a thick fringe across her forehead. Every hair glinted with lights that had nothing to do with its rich black. The glow of the setting sun was on her face too, ripening the amber skin that belonged to all of these comeaways.
You look pretty,
Barty discovered shyly, his eyes lingering.
Go on.
Noonah's oblique glance mocked him. They were approaching the large central building where they ate and sometimes played if it was wet, and where they gathered together to sing in their clear, sweet voices. There was always one mission employee to grow enthusiastic about the way these coloured children sang, and to coach them in hymns and old-time favourites, and to bring them on as a star turn on the occasion of important visitors. A few of the bigger boys and girls came clattering down the steps as they passed. The flywire door crashed behind them, and there was Trilby, long, slim legs dancing, her hair fresh washed, springing alive and springing round her face. She caught sight of Noonah and Barty straight away and came over to them. There were no doubts about these three and their relationship to each other. Wide, low brows, broad and slightly flattened cheekbones, strongly modelled noses with flaring nostrils, and then the clear, sweet curve of lips that parted on square, white teeth. Only Trilby had those strange, light eyes. The others were warm, brown and jetty depths. The whole of the irises showing between wide-open lids. Only Trilby's hair had that sun-struck look. The others had hair the colour of coal, coarse hair that curled softly round their faces.
Still grizzling? Trilby questioned, teasing Barty with a glance.
Before Noonah could answer, a man in a pair of knee-length khaki shorts appeared, brushing the palm of one hand rhythmically across his fat thigh with each brisk step. This was Mr. Norton, the superintendent of the mission. He bent an attentive look on the girls.
One more night for you two, eh? Well, early to bed so you'll be fresh for the trip. It's a long trip, mind you, down to where you're going.
Yes, the girls murmured submissively. The man nodded approvingly, switched his attention to a boy who lounged indolently against a veranda post.
Better give that kikuyu grass another sprinkle tonight, George. Can't have it dying on us, eh?
The boy gathered up his languid body and moved away, unresponsive but obedient. Trilby curled her lip after the man.
Always so damn cheerful, she muttered.
Treating everyone like they were children?
Gee.
Oh, I'll be glad to get away from this place.
Oh, it isn't too bad,
frowned Noonah, reminding her sister of Barty's presence.
Lots of kids like it better than where they come from.
Like to know where they've come from if they like this dump,
Trilby said shortly.
All you kids are going out in the ute tomorrow, aren't you? Noonah asked Barty. Into town? Mrs. Gordon said.
Barty nodded lifelessly.
Oh, now don't start howling, Trilby warned him. You got to stay here if you like it or not. We had to when we were your age, and we were younger when we came too.
Barty tried a valiant sniff, but a few tears chased each other down his cheeks. A couple of boys around his age stopped to stare.
Oh, look at him cry, the bigger one jeered. Oh, cry, baby, come away.
Trilby turned on them furiously.
Get, you kids. Go on. And don't forget Barty isn't the only one around here who cries. What about you two and the way you cried when your mummy came up to see you? Thought she wasn't ever going to get away from you, I bet.
Her grey eyes sparked as the two children made sulkily off.
Never can let anyone alone, she fumed. Always someone around to stick their noses in someone else's business.
She swung round on Barty.
And you? Oh, you make me ashamed you're my brother. You're the big one, aren't you? That has to take care of Stella. Don't you understand that? Shut up,
Noonah spoke sharply.
Barty's coming down with me to see Stella. He'll be all right if you just leave him alone and don't bully him.
Us two are leaving early tomorrow morning, Trilby said gruffly to her brother. If you want to say goodbye, you better do it now.
She bent towards the boy and gave him a hug. Her thin fingers with their oval nails and perfect moons, like delicate shells against the dark skin, slid into the black curly hair. She gave it a tug, a rallying gesture to him to keep his emotion out of sight. Nobody ever saw Trilby in tears. Her world was peopled with enemies waiting to pounce on any such weakness and turn it to their own account, and every observation she made confirmed this fact more fully in her mind.
Come on, Barty, Noonah said gently.
Trilby looked after them, undecided about accompanying them. Then she shrugged and turned in the opposite direction, chin high and eyes narrowed.
Barty had caught some of his sister's fierceness. I'm not a crybaby. I hardly ever cry, do I, Noonah?
You're all right, Noonah said affectionately.
Trilby just said that because she feels like crying herself. She was all worked up and she doesn't know half of what she's talking about when she gets worked up.
About once a year, that's all.
Barty still smarted and his cheeks were still a bit wet.
A woman in a canvas deck chair looked up in surprise as the two approached her. She was accustomed to Noonah's nightly visits, but the girl had already tucked her small sister into bed and kissed her goodnight.
Can we have just one more look? Noonah begged. I'm gone tomorrow and I just thought, Barty and I thought.
They're all asleep in there, the woman said doubtfully. You'll have to be very quiet. One wakes a lot sometimes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.